I'm delighted to be here. Thanks to David and B&H for giving me this opportunity to come back in. What I'd like to talk about today is how I do what I do. We're going to visit two big cats because I primarily have been focusing on big cats for the last few years. But my job is to tell a story, and that's going to be a lot of what I talk about today. My training came from being a photojournalist. I didn't have a background in wildlife photography. I didn't believe in animal portraits just because that's not what I did. I was a photojournalist. When I came into wildlife photography and natural history work, I knew I needed to look at it as telling a story. Animals do not live in a Shangri-La, even though from a lot of the natural history coverage you may see, you would think that they did. We need to tell the story of the animals, the environment, and the people that live with them, or we're doing a disservice to the readers of National Geographic and the viewers and the animals themselves. So that's my job. I'm going to show you two stories today. I had a story in the December issue of National Geographic on America's lion, the mountain lion, or cougar. It was this, I found out this morning, the second most popular story last year. So that's great. So we're going to do two things. We're going to do mountain lions and tigers. If you have questions, it's incredibly important to me that you remember them, and maybe after different sections, if you have a burning question, ask me. So this was a slide my editor made up of the mountain lion story. And it doesn't have a mountain lion in it because mountain lions are the ghost cat. I thought snow leopards were because I did the first snow leopard story. It's very difficult to photograph animals that you will never see. So I started using remote cameras years ago on a story on jaguars. I ended up finding that jaguars are so smart they would go behind my camera when they knew it was there because it was something new in their home and they wanted to know what it was. Once they found out what it was, they decided they didn't like it. But that's jaguars. They're really smart. So on mountain lions, there are no places you can go and see a mountain lion. So I knew I had to work with scientists, which is what I always do, scientists and local people, and a project that worked on mountain lions. And in this instance, it was the Teton Cougar Project funded by Panthera. As you can see here, this is a picture of a mountain lion on an elk hill. These cats wear collars. This one looks a little washed out. That one looks great. This cat's got a collar on it. That's the only way I could find these guys. So we find a kill when we get multiple points on the computer from the signal that's sent from the collar to the satellite and then down into the program the scientists use to track their cats. They would tell us, and we would go in and set a camera trap on the kill. This is shot at the middle of the night. It's a 10-second exposure. I got about 450 pictures this night because the cat was there eating all night long. And then foxes would come. So in remote cameras, I will find the kill, place the beam over the kill, and compositionally, I have no control over the image, which is something I dislike greatly. Because the most important thing to me in photography or art, as far as the physical photograph, is composition. So here's a diagram of the camera traps I used. They were created by National Geographic. The trigger is a Trailmaster. I use an infrared beam because the vast majority of the time when I use remote cameras, I am setting the camera up in a location where I think the cat is going to come, and I compose my image using my assistant as a stand-in for the cat when they would break the beam in my composition. These are hardwired, though we've just had new ones created that have wireless flashes and a wireless signal that when the animal breaks the beam, a signal is sent to the camera and starts taking a photograph. And it has three flashes set up on it. This picture took me 12 months, almost to the day, to get. I got 10,000 pictures of a little field mouse who kept breaking the beam, or 10,000 pictures of nothing because it was so small I couldn't see it. So we knew that sometimes this female and another one would come in when they had cubs to get out of the bitter cold and the snow. And some people ask me, well, how can you wait a year for a photograph? Well, I put a bunch of camera traps up, and in this instance, I was not very happy, but just hoped that something would eventually happen. And it finally did. I put it up in March 2012. I got the picture in March 2013. And there was one frame that was really good. The rest of them were the mom or the cub, or you couldn't see the cub, or you could see the collar really well. And so luckily we got it. And with the sun had just come up, and so we got some of the lake there in the Grovant outside of Jackson Hole, Wyoming. This is another one of those images. Technically wise, when I want to do a picture during the full moon, I love when there's clouds. This is the same exposure as the other one, but you can see that it looks much brighter. So we're trying to find a new way to use camera traps for elusive animals and doing night photography. Well, we never really use pictures at night. So you have to think, how can I make this image good enough that it's going to end up in the pages of the magazine? And shooting during the cycle of the full moon is an idea. And it's a kind of a different and new way to do it. And this is something I'm concentrating on doing now that I got these pictures. Because it's kind of the first time I've ever done it. This is a natural history picture. These next two frames, including this one, were shot by my assistant. Being a photo lecture here, it's extremely important for me that the young people that I work with are able to follow in my footsteps, that they can come to be photographers at National Geographic as long as they do it after I retire. No, I'm just kidding. Right now, Drew Rush, who's a father, 5 days a father, lives out in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. I couldn't come during these months and the camera traps were there, so I said, Drew, just go set up on kills. And you can see this is a natural history event where mountain lions cache their kill. They'll take and cover the kills up, Mother Nature comes in, dumps a foot of snow, it freezes over, and the mountain lion wants to try to get to its meat, so it digs a hole through the snow. And this female stuck her head down there. She'd already gotten a leg and cleaned that up. And then Drew got this, which is another natural history event. Mountain lions do not eat the hair of an animal. So they'll pull it off, and that's what that female's doing right there. And so Drew was able to show that he could do this. And now he's working on his first story for National Geographic. So how I do this is I work with scientists. I have zero background in natural history. Biology, I don't remember what my grade was in high school, but it was probably a C. I just don't have a background in that. My dad taught me photography when I was a young kid, and I became a photojournalist, and one of the first times that I ever went into the wilds down in Costa Rica, I started working with scientists and was moved by their dedication and passion. And I can't do what I do without their knowledge and the knowledge of local people. Now, houndsmen have been used all over the world, specifically in the West, to hunt, track, and in the past, kill mountain lions. Now they track them to place GPS sat collars on them to monitor their movements, because the amount of knowledge about the natural behavior of mountain lions is minimal. We're finding information right now at the Teton Cougar Project by using video and still cameras that is dispelling some of the scientific facts of what mountain lions do. They're not supposed to do this, and then you see them do it in the video or the stills. So I work with houndsmen. They track the cats up a tree, and then they dart them. Usually here, this is a woman who's a grad student in South Dakota. And you know, you're always trying to get a picture of that moment. That cat was just nailed. That's why it's screaming with the tranquilizer dart. And then someone climbs the tree and lowers it down with a rope. Not me. It's Boone Smith, who is the National Geographic Channel's big cat guy. And so photographically, I'm trying to find something that has a bit of tension in a really staid situation. I mean, not much is going on. You get the cat being darted and then it's lowered from the tree. So I use a slow exposure to get the movement. Off-camera light, and then a slow exposure of probably a half second. I'm following the cat, so it's the same as panning someone at the Olympics that's skiing, where everything is moving but the animal. I mean, but the person, in my instance, an animal. So the bottom line with me, and most of these pictures you're going to see, is how do I do something different than has been done the last time? I need to excite my editors and excite the boss upstairs so they look at my story in a way that excites them and then transfers to the readers of the magazine. Now, sometimes some places let the cat fall out of the tree and into a net. And you want to be ready for those action shots because, like I said, not much happens. And in this instance, luckily for these guys, and it could have been unlucky, that cat wasn't drugged yet, so it ran away. And use new methods. Camera trap on itself is somewhat new. Camera traps in the beginning were always used as a record shot. I had to use them on jaguars, and I didn't like them, and I didn't use them for about 10 years till I somewhat foolishly, but in the end not, said I'd like to do snow leopards because of a book I'd read years ago by Peter Matheson called The Snow Leopard, about Dr. George Schaller's work with snow leopards. I had to learn how to use them, and I learned how to use them by using my own composition and setting the picture up like if I was lying there on the ground where this camera was, this is the picture that I would like to get. And luckily, on snow leopards, I was extremely successful. But infrared is something also that we can use. At National Geographic, we've taken a 5D and taken the infrared filter off the sensor. So I use infrared flashes, which are just regular flashes with infrared filters on them, just gel. So the cats don't see what's going on, and I can get pictures of them without them knowing it. How do you photograph scientific work on any drugged animal? If you look at the pages of National Geographic, you may say, I never see these pictures. You're right, you never do, because we fail at telling this part of the story. What we need to do constantly is find a way to compete against ourselves and what we have done in the past and get interesting photojournalism type pictures with the science and the natural history. So these pictures end up in the pages of the magazine. So I'm lying on the ground because I like to get eye to eye with the animals I'm working with. And here's this drug cat that was lowered down from the tree. And this guy steps in front of me and I go, oh, okay, I have a compositional element, and I shoot through the legs. Did it work? Was it published? It was in the iPad edition of the magazine. If you've never seen it, we are the number one electronic magazine in the United States. But we, and it is just incredible. If you've seen it, you know that, because it's totally interactive. On your computer, the maps are interactive, there's videos. It's just, it's a whole new experience looking at National Geographic on the pages of the iPad. And you get a lot more pictures too, and videos that we do. Just trying to show there's some of the measurements in the collar in the picture. This is in right north of LA. There's Boone and some of the scientists, his father on the left. Boone's checking the heartbeat because they always have to keep it stable. So we're looking for moments here also and weighing it. It's not very interesting, but we do it to try to tell the story and challenge ourselves to do it differently. I'm getting ready to do a new story on leopards, and my goal is to get a science picture in the story. Setting up camera traps again, because trying to get pictures of this animal within the system I was working with on federal lands was maddening, absolutely maddening. Day after day after day after day of getting absolutely nothing. And finding this bull elk that was killed by a mountain lion, and then it ran away because it was next to a snowmobile track and it didn't like the sound. And I put a camera trap on it, and it took 3 weeks for a female and her kitten to come in. The meat was great because it's so darn cold that it was just like in a deep freeze. Not like a deep freeze, it was a deep freeze. And here's this little kitten learning how to pull the hair off and spit it out. And there it's like, Mom, what's that? Oh, that's the esophagus. Of course, we would never run a picture like that. But I need to, like I said, tell the story. Now, the mountain lion is not an endangered cat. It's legal to hunt the animal in many Western states. In fact, in many Western states, the mountain lion is still looked at as vermin, though its status is being upped because now most ranchers hate wolves. Other people hate wolves also because wolves will kill dogs. So ranch dogs that are left outside, houndsmen. I knew a houndsman emailed me last year I was supposed to work with, and he and his neighbor lost 5 of their dogs in one night to a pack of wolves. Wolves are bringing back the balance in the ecosystem, so are grizzly bears. And they're moving mountain lions out from areas that they had been in the past. But I needed to show hunts. I'm usually allowed. In many instances, I can't believe somebody's letting me come on a hunt with them. All I'm doing is acting as a journalist. In this instance, I had 5 hunts that were canceled on me. I went to South Dakota, and the guy opened this door, and there was a mountain lion hanging there, and I knew that was a picture, and it was published in the magazine. This cat was killed on the last day of legal hunting in South Dakota because the guy said it was eating his turkeys. Turned out it wasn't his turkeys, they're wild turkeys. But whenever he wanted a turkey, he'd walk outside with his shotgun and kill one. So he didn't like the fact that the mountain lion was killing his turkeys. So it kind of helped to show the situation of this cat out west. And it's really difficult to show the change. And you know, in 3 years, when I first started the research, meeting ranchers that hated lions, and now they love them, because there's usually only one of them instead of a whole pack of wolves. That I can't illustrate. Meeting a hunter and going with him to his taxidermist just to show the progress that he's got on his mount. Wasn't an interesting picture. I'm going to show you things I failed at and succeeded, because the job here is to you to see what I don't think I succeeded at, and the fact that I know it, talk about it, and hope to do better next time. because I look at myself as the person I compete against. I'm not a real competitive kind of guy, because I was always taught that the person I need to compete against is the one that I look at in the mirror every morning. So that's good, I think. Now we move to LA. I tried to get mountain lions out in the wild, and we were very successful, though it was enough to drive a sane person nuts. But I needed the movement of predators into urban areas. It's happening all over the world, and it's happening here in the U.S. They have mountain lions in L.A. There's a place north of L.A. called the Santa Monica National Recreation Area. It's right north of Topanga Canyon Boulevard. It may be a little bit further south, too, up to Oxnard, to the Pacific Ocean in Malibu, over to the 101. There's a population of 15 or 20 mountain lions in there. I wanted to know if it'd be possible to set a camera trap when an animal moves out of the protected area into the suburban areas of North LA to get a picture of the cat with LA in the background. I was told at the mountain lion meeting in Missoula, Montana, or was it Bozeman, in 2011, that it doesn't really happen. Cats will go out, find there's no food, and come back. And I was very depressed, and I told this scientist here, Jeff Sickich from the National Park Service, who's their biologist, golly, wouldn't it be great to get a mountain lion with a Hollywood sign? And he said, well, there's no mountain lions in Griffith Park. But looking at his maps, I could tell that there was a corridor there, and he had already told me that unlike other cats around the world, that young male and female need to disperse to go find their own area. There is no own area. They're stuck in this because the state needs to build a wildlife tunnel under the 101 or over it, so the cats can move north of LA. But they go in the canyons with the big houses on the side, and 8 months later he calls me up and says, you're not going to believe this, because when you asked this question I thought you were crazy, but I was being polite because I'm from the Midwest like you. He said, we got a mountain lion in Griffith Park. It just had his picture taken on the bobcat study cameras. And I'm like, I'll be there in 2 weeks. So here's Jeff monitoring this one cat who's now called P22. And I went to set up camera traps in Griffith Park in Hollywood. I got a lot of different animals. Trying to figure out where this cat went was one of the hardest things I've ever done, bar none. Because not only did I have to place camera traps where the cat went, he had a really bad collar on that we only got 5 points a week instead of 10 points a day. So I got a grant from National Geographic to get him a really good collar, which made the city of LA and Jeff and the National Park Service very happy. Then we could figure out where this cat was going, because part of my problem is to really track these animals. When I'm in the jungle, I use local people or a scientist to track them to figure out where to put these cameras. In this instance, without a view of LA, it's not gonna work. So I got deer, I got people walking their dogs, but I got LA in the background. I got a bobcat. I got a coyote in the Hollywood sign. On lighting, but you know, I started to say, and then I got a bobcat in an area that I knew this was going to be an iconic image if I could get it. Turns out the cat has never gone down this far. This is under the observatory, if anybody's been to Griffith Park, where James Dean was in that famous movie that escapes me right now, that was filmed there. So I knew I was on the right track as far as lighting and getting LA in the background, but I need to find out where the cat was. But I had a major problem. This park has thousands of visitors every day, and I can't put a DSLR and a couple of flashes just sitting out there like I do in the jungle. Because guess what? They get stolen. So I had to figure out a way to make them so it would be too much trouble to steal. I was unsuccessful. But I was successful now. I have video cameras up that I'm taking down next week. I leave for LA tomorrow to go take them down, and they'll be in the National Geographic Channel, a 3-hour series called Urban Jungle. These people don't like my camera traps, obviously, are getting their picture taken. But I got it. I got a mountain lion with LA in the background. So there's P-22. This did run in the magazine, but really small. But my goal was to get an iconic picture that would just blow people away. It's like, we live with these animals and we do not know it. Why don't we know it? Because they want nothing to do with us. And once we figure that out, you know, we'll all be better off and not get all worked up about the fact that a mountain lion may live there, and, you know, be intelligent about it and find a way to coexist. And that was the picture. Took me 15 months to get this picture. If you'll notice, the lighting is very specific. I got one picture beforehand and you could see the collar too well. So I relit it at a kind of 90 degree angle so you couldn't see it. And I don't like my image to be totally lit. I want your eye to go directly to the animal, so I light it in a very specific way.
So how many shots did you
get? One.
That's it?
That is it. It's right there. You're seeing it. I did get one a month later. Only one flash was working, luckily the one on the right, and that's also a really great picture. It's a 4-second exposure. The Hollywood sign is not lit. It used to be when it said Hollywood Land many, many years ago, but a lot of people live around there now and they didn't like it lit. So that is the light bouncing off the fog. Now, many years ago, I wanted to find a way when the iPad came out to make my camera trap pictures come alive. And so I asked downstairs in photo engineering and next door at remote imaging if it would be possible to take a DSLR and make a video HD camera trap out of it. My initial answer was no. One word, no, that's it. Last January, so that's 13 months ago, without me knowing it, they had made it. This is what we got. And that's how the National Geographic Cougar Story in December iPad edition began. Not with a photograph, but with that video, right after John Stanmeyer's story on the trek across Africa and the world. So that was cougars. I'm going to talk about tigers. I started working on tigers in 2000. One or two, something like that. But here again is where tigers win, because people think this looks fake. And it's not the picture I wanted. It was the first day I set the camera trap up, so my lighting wasn't the way I wanted it. But with tigers and water, you can only put the light where you can, you know? So it was the first day Curious Cubs came in. But getting back to how I started it, I was invited to Burma or Myanmar by Dr. Alan Rabinowitz in maybe it was 2002 or 2003, that eventually became a story on life in the Valley of Death. It was called the Hukong Valley. It was called the Valley of Death for many reasons. A lot of malaria, the fact that the local indigenous people would bury in mounds, and people came up and said, what's that? And so, and it used to be during World War II where they flew over the hump from India into Burma. And so I went there, and then I did another story, then another story, and we put it together. It was my wife's idea into the book Tigers Forever, which is right up here, which you saw. And we put all that work into a book, but I'm going to tell you the story of all those years. Now, I didn't check the time. How long do I have? I better start talking a lot faster. So I went with Alan Rabinowitz. You need to show scientists in the field. One way to do it is if they're on an elephant, you pretty much have a darn good picture. Or something that's interesting as just a record of that individual. I went there to cover the tiger team in this area. And what they were doing was setting camera traps to quantify the existence of this park. Are there enough animals there? Aren't there enough tigers, elephants, leopards, bears? So it's really boring to take a picture of guys setting up a camera trap, but you find the best way to do it. Have the flash go off, tiger tracks right there. They want to count tigers, so you find where tigers are walking to place the camera. Like I said, I'm working with scientists. The reason why I went there is we were on another expedition, and he said, pointed out the window, he said, see that big blanket of green? That should be your next story. And when we get back to Yangon, we'll go to the office and I'll show you the pictures that we're getting. And the pictures that he was getting are on the wall behind, but these are, they're identifying the tigers. Because tigers' stripes are like our fingerprints. They're unique to that individual, so if you put cameras on both sides of the trail, they can identify individual animals. And my job when I was there is, how do I get a picture of this? Well, it was pretty easy because I didn't have to do anything. They were using an old-fashioned magnifying glass to look at the pictures to try to identify individual tigers. And boom, looking over the shoulder of a guy, there was my picture. Now, every story needs to have landscapes, images in it. And so I'm always looking for locations. In this instance, I had seen on this river, that's actually my boat that I had made for $30. It's made out of mahogany. Too bad I couldn't bring it home. And the person that I worked with, Apu, who was the number one hunter of the area, and so helped me to track animals. I noticed on the left there's this area, and every day we would see gold miners coming on their elephants or walking to this one spot to camp. So I knew at 4:30 in the afternoon we got beautiful light, and I just hung out there and waited for guys to come because it was one of the only locations, one of the thickest forests I've ever worked in my life. Impenetrable jungle is what this was. That this was a location that I could show my landscape and just wait for what I'd hope would be there. And I had to go back many times. Not as often as you do for animals, but I got the picture. It ran a double page in the magazine. This is how I move on certain expeditions. I have a lot of equipment. I have camera traps. I have long lenses. I have tents, sleeping bags, food. And so they're moved by elephant up to the base camp of the tiger team. And my cook is in the background, is a man that I've hired for years in Myanmar. His name's Pati. He's a great cook, and he's crossing the river there with his umbrella. One thing, I was never dry on this trip, and I was never without leeches all over my legs. But part of this story was a test for me. And it was really good that I was a photojournalist, because when I got to this location, all of a sudden I saw trucks everywhere. I thought this was some remote valley in the middle of nowhere. They found gold. And so between the time that I had proposed the story and the time I went, gold was found, and 100,000 people came into the forest. I was really bummed out, and when I got finally into the edge of this area, saw all these trucks, it was at night, and I didn't know what to do, and I went, yeah, you do. You're a photojournalist. You tell the story about what's going on here. And it became a story about the local people, how they use the natural resource of their forest, which is done all over the world, and I hadn't ever seen it. So this was a good challenge for me, and it actually told the story. What are 100,000 miners eating? And on, it was an education for me about how our natural areas are used. And I was the first Westerner to go to the end of the Burma Road since 1945. We almost didn't make it because we almost went off the road. And luckily there was a big boulder there that stopped us from going over and over and over and off a cliff. But that's what the road looked like. So I went into the gold mining areas. I found these scales at every small little store that the miners would immediately go in and with their gold and buy things. So I tried to find a way to make a picture of those scales and to show what was going on. Here's where one of the miners came from, the rice paddy agriculture area of central Burma, and came up here. And you can see what the forest looks like now. A giant pit. 7-8 square miles were totally cleared for these mines. When the story came out, the mines were closed and the forest came back. One of the interesting things about this is they were finding all kinds of plane crashes from World War II, and they pulled a piece of metal out, and one of the miners gave it to me. It said, "Long Range Fuel Tank, Cincinnati, Ohio," on it. And big props, all kinds of stuff. You know. But in this instance, it helped save it. Here is an image. You know, when you're doing things like this, I don't have a background. It's one of my first natural history stories. I mean, I'd been doing it for a while, but we met a poacher. He had just killed a sambar deer, and I'm learning, I didn't know this, that you can't kill the food of the animal you're trying to save. You can't eat all the sambar deer, which is what the tigers love. It's like an elk. And expect to have tigers. You don't need to kill tigers to actually bring about their demise. And 100,000 miners didn't bring a supermarket with them, or a chicken farm or a pig farm. So they're killing what's there. And this guy didn't want to show his face, so I ended up getting this picture. I didn't know anything about traditional Asian medicine or traditional Chinese medicine. This was my learning experience. The Burma Road opened. Supply and demand. Huge movement of animals out of this area while I was there. These guys were escaped convicts. Apu, the guy I was with, stopped them and asked them what they had gotten. And they were using a black powder rifle, looked like something from the Revolutionary War. And they were trying to shoot it to get the gallbladder and for the Asian traditional medicine market. And they accidentally shot it through the gallbladder. And so this picture became known as the $8 bear, because I asked them, can you ask them, because I had to go through a couple of translators to ask them how much they'd make. They said $2 a paw. Oh, here's something. Sometimes you feel like you shouldn't be a photographer and you're useless. You can't find a picture. I couldn't find a way to photograph these four paws. The guy's standing there, he's got this hat cocked on his head, he's got a cheroot in his mouth. Perfect, but I wanted all four paws and get the other guy in it. And it just dawned on me to do this, but never give up. There are days where all of us feel like we shouldn't have the job we have and we're no good. Because you get in ruts and you just can't think of something to do when an opportunity presents itself, because this is an illustrative portrait, but I need this picture because I'm not gonna find anybody with a tiger skin most likely that he just killed, or a couple of elephant tusks over his shoulders. So you need to find pictures of what present itself at that time. How do you take a picture of a table sitting on the street that has tiger bone, elephant skin, macaque skulls? I tried close, far. This is the picture that ran. Shadows of the street of the bicycles and the table. Though I took this picture also, this is elephant skin and individual packages of tiger bone. Tiger bone is tiger marrow, and so it probably has some kind of properties if you're eating the marrow of any animal. But it doesn't do anything else. But I took that picture. It's a point picture, but I used it because nobody has pictures of tiger bone. Now, I'm in the forest. I'm not getting any pictures of animals because I'm with Apu, who was the best hunter of the area. Turned out he really was the best hunter of the area. There's no animals left. We slept in a tree. I got the best night's sleep I had gotten for years, sleeping in a platform in the tree that he used for hunting. It was great, but we never saw any animals. He said my snoring kept them away. But I think he was probably sleeping also. So one day we heard explosions in the river and ran down from where we were camping, and there was guys dynamite fishing. They'd come up river in one of these bamboo rafts that they just make there. And I ran out to photograph it. People, whoa! And they're dynamite fishing, using the forest and using the rivers. And all of a sudden they were screaming that this raft was coming down. It missed me by this much. This was the opener of the story. The people that use the forest in these areas, guy had gone up to get certain plants to put a new roof on his house. And that's him coming down. That's how I ended up going out of the forest the next day. They built a raft, and I trusted these guys so much, I actually put my tripod with the 600 and tied it down on the raft, and we floated all the way down with it. I never saw anything, but any animals to use a 600 for. And this was a picture, you know, something that just happened. Here's a guy. I actually was with his son walking by to go photograph them hunting. And I looked inside and saw this man sitting there with some candles in front of this trophy board that I'd heard about, a board that they use to place skulls in reverence for the animals that they've killed for food. And before they go out, they'll pray in front of this trophy board. And I just use the light of the candles and then a side flash to mimic the sunlight, coming in through the doorway. And I just asked him to sit. He was sitting there anyway. But it became an interesting thing. I also took a detail of it that ran as a double page in the magazine. The most important part of this picture is the fact that his son didn't have a trophy board. I asked him, did he used to hunt macaque monkeys for anything other than food? Because I started to see him on those tables in the town when I would come in and out of the country. And he said no. So it was part of the trade, and as it was ramping up, because they had a easy road, trade route to China now, that they were taking out everything, elephants, tigers, leopards, bears. So, the scientists had a couple of social scientists with them also, and they had told me about a Naga shaman. Naga used to be headhunters, and he had a tiger skin hat and a tiger necklace. And I wanted to go there to ask him, when was the last tiger that you ever saw? And he said it was translated two times from Naga to Burmese, Burmese to English. He said, I'm wearing it. So I wanted to get a picture of him. He was an incredible man. It was my birthday, and he knew, found out, and he was singing me a song. And I just laid on his bamboo floor while he sang a song with the fire pit there, and I got a picture that ran in the magazine. And he was always smiling. They told me he was smiling because he insisted on putting that fertility basket in the upper left-hand corner. And he thought that was funny. All right, so the next story I did was Kaziranga. I wanted to illustrate a national park somewhere in the world, a park that was of vital importance to certain species, namely the Indian one-horned rhino, and others also, that was under attack by humans coming right on the edge of the park and putting a lot of pressure, cutting off any migratory routes, and to do a story on this incredible place that is Kaziranga National Park in northeastern India and Assam. It's home to over 80% of the remaining one-horned rhinos, the largest population of Asian elephants left in the world, and the largest population of wild water buffalo, Asian water buffalo, and the highest density then of tigers anywhere in the world. So my job was to go and do a story on the park, not just the animals, but all the threats that they face having so many people. So I have to tell a whole story. No Shangri-La thing about just animal pictures like they live in this place and they never have to worry about any problems. Kaziranga is being under an incredible lot of pressure by poachers for rhino horn. They don't kill the tigers. Actually, the tigers are totally protected there because it's the only location where they have a shoot-to-kill policy in India. And the guards have guns, and they have old Royal Enfield rifles. They're getting new ones, I heard now. But anything in India takes quite a while to do, but these guys are crack shots. So they got poachers with AK-47s, and who wins? The guards. Because they're crack shots, because they're constantly shooting warning shots in front of rhinos that are charging them. So I did the elephants, set up camera traps. I went to the park when it was still closed, found locations when it was still flooded. The Brahmaputra's on the north. The park floods in many instances where the animals have to move. And I wanted to give myself a challenge. I want a landscape picture done with a camera trap with one of the signature species. And I got this picture of a rhino coming out of the water. I call it Dino Rhino because it looks like a dinosaur, because part of him is wet and part of him is dry. And he just came out of the water. This is 5:30 in the morning. And this is Kaziranga with the beels, the lakes, and the river, the cane that's hanging, that's they call it cane there. It's rattan. And the elephants love eating the rattan. But to cover the lives of the guards, because these are the guys that protect it, you need to tell their story. They're under constant attack, whether it's by rhinos, elephants, bears, and poachers. And you never see pictures of these guys. How can you tell a story without the people that protect them? I mean, we need to have armed guards. We have them in our national parks. We have police here. They need police in the forest. And we need to tell their story. So, I mean, this is a real event. Most of the time you're with them and nothing's happening. Well, right now, right before I took this picture, and I was kneeling down to look up at them, give them some more power than shooting straight on at them, three gunshots had just gone off, and we thought it was poachers. And immediately the man in the middle, he put his gun up in the direction because he thinks bullets are going to start flying at us. And we were in this grassy area around the edge of a lake. My wife was right behind me, and I was thinking about get low for another reason. So I don't have a bullet, because I'd already had a bullet come 6 feet from me, and you can hear him whizzing by in another instance the week before. So we got a shot of a little bit of tension with these guards and the fire that they had there. It's surrounded by people that have farms. It's surrounded by tea gardens that have been there since the 1840s. A lot of times you start photographing something and you go back and look at it. The Jeep was going down the road. We had to go in to talk to the director of the park. This is something else that I'll say. You get to know all these people that will control your lives and the permissions that you're asking for and become their friends. We're coming back. At the end of the day, everybody's coming out of the tea garden to get their tea weighed and find out how much they made for the day. I took I don't know how many pictures till all the women went home. This is the first frame, and it ran really big in the magazine. So sometimes it's just like boom, and just take the picture, compose, composition, and you do it, and then boom, it's the first frame. So that's good. This guy turned out to be a tiger. They called him Tiger Killer because he had speared a tiger that was caught in his brother's home because of the monsoon, and they couldn't get it out, so he unfortunately killed it. I was just there photographing these guys trying to break apart this hard earth to start planting rice. I mean, the picture never ran, but you try to do what you can do and get something. This is the first tiger I ever saw in my life. He was surprised. He was sleeping. Come around the corner, boom, you take a picture. And you, the other thing I don't do besides bait is I don't crop. I won't crop a picture. If I fail, well, I fail. Better luck next time. I mean, some people crop everything, but I just don't, because in the beginning we couldn't, because what were we shooting? Slide film. And we didn't crop. So that was a good lesson for me. But I'm a little bit older than some of my assistants that just look at cropping as natural. So I'd be sure to break them of that habit. You have a camera, you have a frame, you have composition. It's the most important part of photography is composing. You want to go learn about composition? Go to the Met. Because painters used composition. You don't need to look at just the masters of photography, though you do. But you want to look, go back and study composition to make your photographs and your eye move around the frame, give them tension. Now, the hardest thing to do, you can read about human-animal conflict all the time, but do you see pictures of it? No. You hear about animals trampling, elephants trampling villages and stuff in India and Africa. I didn't know there weren't any pictures of it. So all we heard that there was a herd of elephants that were on their migratory route, and there just happened to be a new village that wasn't there last year, there now. And they were stuck. They didn't know what to do. And it was a who's on first thing with the local people. They were running from one end and people running from the other end. So the elephants would just run into another mad group of people and then they would turn around and go the other way. And I ran till I was totally exhausted. And then the bullets started flying because they were there trying to shoot in the air. And then the police came and decided, forget shooting in the air, we'll just shoot. And luckily nobody died. So I was there and trying to photograph this whole situation. Now, talking about making friends with the people that control your lives, you're there. They're not used to any media being there. Someone had said before that most people that go to India don't go to Kaziranga, and that's true. Over 80% of the tourism is local, as in they're Indians from India. Now, I made friends with this guy. He was somewhat forward-thinking, and he knew that to be able to get support for his park, the problems that they had needed to be shown in the media. The local media, very political, one side or the other, one problem or no problem, and it was great that National Geographic was there. So he actually called me, because I convinced him that I needed his help. I showed him camera trap pictures that he'd never seen before, and he called and said that an elephant had been killed with a local bullet, homemade bullet soaked in acid. The animal died of septicemia. And it died in a village where they didn't shoot him. It took 3 days to die. And they come out to move from the park across the road into the mountains because it's safe, it's somewhere to go. But they pass by a candy store, which is rice that's ready for harvest. And to be able to get this picture to tell the story is vitally important because we don't see this. Most people want you not to see the problems that they have, but it was really affected people. It's in the tiger book, people saw it's not a tiger. But yes, but this is a common problem. Tigers need, as I said before, with dispersing males and females, and the guy that ended up in Griffith Park, they need room to move. Elephants migrate. They need that area to migrate without roads and oil refineries. Assam is the number one oil exporter in India. And they put an oil refinery right in the middle of the elephant's century-old migratory route, a giant oil refinery. And so they get stuck here and they get shot. And so in a small way, this one elephant will help to tell the story of the problems with conflict. All right. Now, this picture was vitally important to me, but it didn't exist when it became vitally important to me. What became important to me was that I want eye-to-eye intimate views of animals that I can't take without ending up as their dinner. That's why I use camera traps. I tracked a female and cub from the near road into the high elephant grass. It wasn't so high here because this elephant grass gets to 24 feet, 27 feet. But I wanted a picture of a tiger or an animal, but eye to eye. And I wanted to be able to put it here because I knew a female and her cub were walking here. But the guy that was helping me, the director of Kaziranga National Park, said, "Steve, it's too dangerous." I said, "I'll pay for 4 or 5 guards." And of course he said, "No, because they're already working. They were just given to me." And he said, "It's too dangerous." And then that afternoon, I'm all bummed out. I go check a camera, and this is what was on the camera. I put this camera trap up on the only place they could walk that wasn't wet. And this rhino had been mating with the female in the background. She broke the beam. This is one of the few times I have a picture that's not number one. This was frame number 7. Because once they break the beam, I have it set to take 10 pictures. This animal looks right in the lens. Been fighting with another male for the right to mate with this female. And he's got blood running down his horn and pooling right there. And he's looking right in the camera. And he didn't ruin the camera, number 2. Because rhinos will ruin the camera, elephants will ruin the camera, just trash it, you know, in pieces, everything's in pieces. But he didn't do that, and we got this picture. So this park's concentrated on rhinos, so I bring this picture in, and I said, "Look what I got," and he goes, "We've never seen anything like this before. This is what you're trying to do?" Because it was like the first couple weeks I was there. And he goes, "I'll give you guards to go get this picture." And so this is what I got. The reason why it takes me 3 or 4 hours to set one of these camera traps up, because I want to camouflage it real well so they don't know it's there, and to put the lights in different places, not on top of the camera. I want indirect lighting. Here it worked as much as it could, but I surely didn't expect. I got this cat at 1:30 in the morning. This is 1:33 in the afternoon. I didn't expect him to be there. It's just great. And it's an accessible image. It looks like the cat is smiling. This spent 6 months at about 40 foot long on front of the museum in Washington, D.C., 2 blocks down from the U.S. Capitol. So it's accessible. It brings people into tigers again. That means I win and tigers win. And it was a double page in the magazine. They cropped it. I didn't. If you saw the Kaziranga story, they blew the tiger up. They're allowed to do it. They're the bosses. But in this area, there weren't any. And then because of that, these rhinos end up dead and their horns cut off. I didn't want to show the fact that it's had its horn cut off, so I put this guy's foot there. I didn't put it there. I just waited and just sat in one spot while they were walking back and forth looking for shell casings. They put a piece of straw in the bullet hole so they could see right where the poacher shot it and wait for that shot. Another, you get these guys to like you. Are they going to call you and tell you we've been beating up poachers and we got them blindfolded and handcuffed behind them? No, they're not going to. But they sure did call me. That's why when you do these things, we need to make friends with the people we work with. I've always been this way. I appreciate these guys. The guy that called me, we just were drinking whiskey a couple days before on a national holiday, and you become their friends. You know, we have things in common, and I want them to let me know when certain things happen, and they were losing so many rhinos. And it was because of these guys, you know, and they caught them. But the rate of them getting actually in jail is something like 2 to 3% in India. Yes?
Japan?
No, I do not. That's another thing I don't do. It feels wrong to me. You know, I give all the scientists and people I work with equipment. P22 in LA is wearing a National Geographic collar, and so are 2 other cats. Those collars cost $4,500 a piece. The guards need shoes. They need coats. I bring boxes of stuff that they can use, walkie-talkies, GPS, stuff that they can really use, cameras. They're just dying to photograph everything that they see. Tracks, poaching problems, illegal cattle in the park. Because the cows have hoof and mouth, you could lose all 80% of all the remaining one-horned rhinos in 6 months if they got hoof and mouth. What did I do? I brought in a vet, free USAID vaccine that's sitting in the Capitol. I did it on snow leopards, and I did it here. Vaccine's already there. You just need someone to say, hey, we need it now, and get it out into the field. So I help in any way I can, but it just, I don't give somebody money to help me photograph what they're doing. I've tried to find other ways in kind to help them. That was a long answer. Sorry. Yes.
So give us a sense of how the economics involved.
Oh, I get paid. All right. All right. Let's go on a nicer picture. All right. Tiger scratch for communication. I see this picture. It's not good enough. I'm with the Alan Rabinowitz. He's smelling because they have scent glands all over their body, including between their toes. They scratch to show a male, this is my territory, a female. Say, hey, you come to this tree often? I'm here. Yeah. So my job is to find a different way to photograph this picture. So I placed a camera at 14 feet looking down the tree. Okay, that's a better picture. I like this, because like a cat, their eyes closed, they're going like that, just like your cat at home. And there he's looking up at the camera. All right, you come up with an idea. You research it, you find people that can help you. You do quite a bit of research, you write a proposal. It goes to one of your editors at National Geographic, they take it to the story committee. You also do a budget, and then it's approved or not. They may, you know, adjust whatever. Oh, maybe you should do this, or maybe you should do that. And it's 100% covered by the magazine and the subscribers and the supporters of the National Geographic Society. A magazine's still nonprofit entity, so. Yeah, everything. I just have to figure it out, which takes a lot of research to figure out what the, you got to know what you have to pay for permits. Is there a camera fee every day in the park? All kinds of things. How much does the Jeep cost? Fuel, place to stay, food, all this, you know, to be able to do it. And it's all covered by the magazine.
What about your fee?
Oh, that's just a standard fee at Geographic, and it's done on, you know, per story time. We're all called contract photographers, so that we work story to story. And I'm still there, I hope partially because I get things like the Hollywood Cougar, and you're constantly wanting to find new ways to do things. I don't want, oh, I remember seeing that picture a few years ago in the magazine, done by someone else. I don't want people to say that about what I do. I want to try to get something that's uniquely mine. Because as I say, the challenge is to save our planet and get kids interested and our generation interested again. Yes, please.
Do you work with a writer?
Yes, I do work with a writer. But I don't all the time because they don't have as much time as I have. I take too much time sometimes because I am trying to get these images in the writer. We may cross paths and we do cross paths, but we don't spend a lot of time together. It would be great because two heads are better than one, and you start becoming so tunnel visioned about what you're doing that it's great to have somebody else actually there. We may correspond by email or things like that, but I really appreciate having somebody I can talk to about different ideas. Natural history events are incredibly important. You hope for something like this. You hope for a tiger that's hunting elephant babies and then watch him walk in and get a signature image of why tigers have stripes. You know, the grassland had just burned. And to get this picture, the only thing on my mind when I took this was the fact that the 600 with the 1.4 was getting too long, but I can't switch lenses because he's walking really close to me and I got to get what I can get. And it was the last frame before he was too big in the frame. But I got this image, which is great.
On an elephant in a car?
I'm in these little gypsies, they call them. It would be a Jeep. It's like a Jeep and a shrinking machine, like the incredible shrinking Jeep. Suzuki Maruti, puny little Jeeps. I mean, we usually didn't see too much in the Jeep, and it was just the tiger. I'm in an area people can't go, and he's just lying on the road. And he would go into the herd, and then the matriarch would come, trumpet, and he'd go back to the road, lie down, go to sleep. 20 minutes later, he'd get up, go back in the herd. And this is when he finally got bored and said, I'm not getting an elephant baby today. And so he walked away. And you wait months for something like this to happen, yeah. You know? All right, I'll tell you how I do things. Back button focus. My focus is my thumb.
Yeah.
I don't know if everybody does it. I did it in 1991 when Canon first put back button focus on. And I use the center focusing point only unless I'm shooting flying birds.
Right.
Because I got to look through, I think I was looking through here or here. I remember where my friggin' focusing point was because it'll drive you nuts. I mean, I'm not going to miss a frame because the camera is functioning the way it wants to. I don't shoot automatic. I don't shoot anything on automatic. The reason we switched to Nikon for camera traps is to get a certain function that helps us to shoot on aperture priority. So we miss less images when it's dawn or dusk, when the light's low and doesn't go to 2, 4, 8, 10, 30 seconds. But I focus like that because focusing is a vital, important part, but our cameras force us to do things that we should be doing on our own. You don't let something tell you what to do. Learn how to do it the way you want to and make it do it that way. Because we only have split seconds to get these images, whether they're animals or people or whatever. And if something happens, that's why I said, that shutter button's function is what? To take the picture, nothing else. Because I control my exposure, I control my focus. That's why I focus, compose. Instead of, I focused, but then I forgot to hold it halfway down and it refocused. Excuse me, you're the boss. Make the camera do what you want it to do. I learned that years ago, and then I'd worked with Apple Computer in the past, and that was always their mantra. It's supposed to work for you. And all our programs make things do it. And it's like, yeah, and the cameras. And people come with me to problems when I do workshops or something. I said, we need to redo how to use that camera. Because it is just a tool. And it's if things aren't going the way you want them, then it's not working how you need it to work. We're just getting to tiger stories. So I decided we needed to do a new tiger story, and I wanted to do it in 3 countries. The next tiger to go extinct would be in Sumatra. The most successful tiger project was in Thailand, now Sumatra also. And then you have to go to India. Camera trap again, first day. Wanted it over the water hole. How could I put it anywhere else but smack dab in their face? This helped to show it. The female came in to check out on the first day. What is this? What does it smell like? All that kind of stuff, you know? And I got this image on the first day with that paw picture. And I'll show you a bunch of those camera traps later on. Sumatra, I got there. One of the biggest problems is totally cutting down the island for palm oil and the problems with habitat destruction. And, you know, working with the guards here in the forest again, there's a mahout on an elephant checking for illegal logging. So that became my forest picture because I have a compositional element right in this part of the frame. I like saying, you know, there's a compositional tool that you have four compositional points here, up here, over there, and over there. And somehow our composition, in many instances, revolves around those points. And when I photograph this, that's where I put them. And I need to photograph death and destruction. I have problems with here. A lot of these palm oil plantations are guarded by the Indonesian military, and they wanted me not to be there. So I was having people stop me from doing my job, and I wasn't very happy about it. But I got some, they're moving families from Java to Sumatra, and everybody gets 5 hectares of land. They cut down the forest. And so I was able to get this, but I thought I'd get more death and destruction. Here's a family just came from Java cutting down the trees to build their home. And then they're going to grow palm oil. I worked in an area that didn't have a whole lot of palm oil, so I felt that that part of the story was lacking. Hunters, these guys trap pigs because they don't want the pigs coming in to eat their corn. They don't eat them because they're of the Muslim faith, but they sell them to the Malay Chinese in the main towns. And I saw this on the first day I was there. These guys had used their dogs in this little tricycle, and I got this shot. The threats to tigers, I was in a forest in an area that we were heard we might be able to put a camera trap in a cave, and came upon a tiger trap with a puppy in it. There was more than one. There's 3 snares in this photograph. Tiger comes in to try to get the puppy, and there's 3 snares that will capture him. The man that set this and his son had been responsible for killing 160 tigers between them. And because of all this, they got arrested. I don't know whatever happened to them, though. Snares are set by the people that come in. They plant their palm oil, but it takes 5 years to get a crop. They go work for one of the larger areas or grow crops for subsistence farming, but they set snares because they got to feed their family. But snares are indiscriminate. They also catch tiger cubs, like this cub that was captured in a snare for 4 days and had his right front leg removed. And he had pulled the stitches open, and so they had darted him in the cage to redo surgery on him to help save his life. And he lives his life in a zoo outside of Jakarta. And I love the ranger on the right there holding his tail. So you look for moments like this. You know, I'm just following him, photographing the whole surgery and follow him out, and this guy comes by and just goes like that. Boom. I mean, the shot didn't run, the cub in the cage ran, and I knew it. When that thing snarled at me, the poor little cub, first one his ears were back, but the one that I showed you was the one that ran in the magazine. Well, this is out of order. But you want to cover things that in Africa, they're common. You take ex-poachers, ex-loggers, make them guards. Give them a paycheck. But I need to photograph that. They want a paycheck. They don't want to have to poach. Every 2 weeks they get money for their family. They're overjoyed. And who better to catch a poacher than an ex-poacher? So I'm out with these guys, and I'm walking in this mud or trying to move. But I need to photograph that. A judge finally put an order in. 80,000 square hectares of a national park for 15 years has been a palm oil plantation. A judge signed an order. It's gone. The guys that harvest the palm oil are going to cut all of it down. That's 302 square miles. And so this is a positive thing. And I'm hoping to get a shot of these guys cutting these trees down and something different. With the wildlife police burning out an old logging camp because the illegal loggers are there. And they moved away, and then they moved back. They move away because a tiger killed 7 of them. So they left. And it was 6 months later, they went, well, Maybe the tiger's not around anymore, but they came back and the wildlife police were. While I'm there with the guys, that's the next day, while I'm there and they're burning out that guy, one of the wildlife police gets a text saying that a tiger has been poached out of the local zoo. The zoo's not locked, the cage is not locked. Why would it be locked? We just had, we're here, we all know everybody. They threw her a piece of meat with tranquilizers in it, and they gutted her and deboned her from what they could. And so I went, all right, right away I knew, how do you take a picture of an empty cage? I knew I was gonna have a day to figure that out, and to be successful or unsuccessful, I knew I wasn't gonna make it, but I was gonna try. But the first thing I did was, can you text the zoo to ask the keeper whether he has pictures of this tiger? And if he does, can we get the file, make pictures of it? So I had pictures made, because I knew it was gonna be an illustrative picture. We had the images made. I'm standing in front of the cage. They opened the doors on a Sunday. This was killed on Friday night. I went there on Saturday and got nothing. And this family comes in, and this little girl came to see the tiger, and they didn't know it had been killed. I asked her father, or through translators, would she mind holding this picture of Sheila that they came to see? And this picture ran in the magazine. So you have to think, how can I do this? How can I be successful? I've been given this opportunity, horrific thing. Tiger killed for $100. She lived 16 years in this zoo. And this little girl and I made this picture, the police tape behind, and it was perfect. I like this frame the best, and partially because that guy's looking in the background there. So don't give up. I left Sumatra without getting a picture of a Sumatran tiger. I left my camera traps up, and luckily a month afterwards of stress and worrying that I didn't get a picture of one of the few subspecies of tigers left, I got an email from Fauna and Flora International, which is a UK conservation organization, and the director of it in Bondache said, Steve, you have an exceptional image of a Sumatran tiger. I immediately wrote back, are there any water spots in front of its face? And please send me a JPEG. And this is one of the only, except for some scientific camera trap picture, it's the only like pro picture of a Sumatran tiger that illustrates what is unique about a Sumatran tiger. They have a mane like a lion. Just great. I picked this location because there's a great view in the background, except not at 3:30 in the morning. But I lit it in a downpour, and the lighting still stayed because there was nobody there, and we got a great shot. I went to Thailand because I'd read a scientific paper that in Hoi Kai Kang, on the Thai-Burma border, is a huge protected area. And Dr. Alan Rabinowitz, during the 80s, went to sleep every night hearing gunshots, machine guns, poachers coming in and clearing the area of animals, food, and traditional Chinese or Asian medicine. So I went there to work with the Thai tiger team and to try to get pictures of the Indo-Chinese tiger and cover the science of rewilding Hoi Kai King again to bring it back to its former glory of an intact ecosystem. This is actually a cub who'd been tranquilized. It is the first ever project on female tigers ever done. What's their home range? How much land do they need to hunt when they have cubs? Where do they go when they go out of the park, and do they make it alive, which is what they're doing right now, their new project? So I went there to work with them. They'd been camera trapping for years to ID individual cache to know how many tigers they had. Here again, you're standing on the ground, looking at them at a table, and I go, how am I gonna do this? They were freaking out because they were losing tigers in one area. So they had pictures laid out, and I looked up and went, do you guys have a ladder? And I crawled up, it was an open air, just a roof, and so I climbed up on the rafters, and You can see, you can't see it right now. Oh yeah, right there. In his hand, in his hand is a tissue. Because 110 degrees and I'm sweating all over their tiger pictures. But you find ways to do pictures differently. Shoot from above. I lay on the ground half my life. My camera traps are almost on the ground so I can look eye level or up. But stand up, kneel down, lie down, get a ladder. Try to find different ways to shoot things so you give your editor a great variety of images. It's incredibly important. Picture, I don't know if it ran or not. Oh, maybe it did. I can't remember. One of the reasons these guys are successful, besides the science, is that they have an innovative program called the Smart Patrol Rangers, and I need to go out with these guys and watch them when they're on patrol. Go with them when they're training with the Thai military and Thai police, because it is actually a war with the poachers. So I'm out with these guys, and you know, some of them had been in the army before, and so we're on the shooting range in the national park, and trying to find a different picture to get to illustrate this. Camera trap picture, I didn't like it. But we're having trouble getting pictures. And I thought it would be easy. They put bait out to try to get these tigers. So they put a few cows in the forest. They got what they wanted. They never wanted me to put cameras on it. Or I said, I don't want to put cameras on it because I need to get a daytime capture. So they got a female hit one. I said, how do you know it's a female? They can tell by the tracks. And so they said, we got a male hit this other cat. You can put a camera up. All my cameras were out because I was having so much trouble getting pictures of these tigers. All I had was an infrared camera left, but I really liked the picture of the tiger there. Here's an instance where I would tell everybody to see the best natural history coverage in the magazine ever, in my estimation, is the Serengeti lion story from August. Nick Nichols, I was his assistant 30 years ago. Brent Sturton, photojournalist. You might know him if you remember the Newsweek cover years ago, the dead gorillas coming out of the forest on the stretchers, cover in Newsweek. Brent never shot wildlife before then, and that was kind of an accident that happened. But this is a boring picture, but it's something I see all the time, guys with radios. Brent's got an amazing picture of the lion guardians, Maasai teenagers, and what I'm doing with, and the bands on the other one's ankle. Look at the picture, and I constantly do it. This is a failure. There was only one guy out there. I wasn't successful, but what I'm trying to say is find a journalistic way to cover things that maybe aren't so visually exciting. Because that's our goal, is to get science in the magazine. But this picture has things going on throughout the frame. This is collaring one of these female tigers. It's Anchara's project. She's getting her PhD. This is her husband, Soxit, who is head of all tiger research and tigers in Thailand. He is actually listening right now to the heartbeat of the unborn cub in the mom. So there's the future of Thai tigers, or the Indo-Chinese tigers, right there. And I do a lot of captures, but this is one of the best pictures I ever got. Cubs, we all love cubs, and the same thing happened one night. They got a cub, and it magically woke up. Now, you see this light. There is no light. I can't focus trying to get a headlamp in there. This is a softbox, you know, portable, that I have someone holding, just a little one. And so I'm trying to focus, and all of a sudden, boom, this cub wakes up. And he was a feisty little guy. But everybody loves pictures of cubs, so I got this image. But we didn't run it. Now, I finally got a picture of Indo-Chinese tiger coming into this marking tree right here. It's going to spray and mark its territory. And the way I like using my lights at different angles, as you can tell. And so I got a picture that I enjoyed, and it was at dusk. So, and then I went to India. I'll have to talk fast.
There it is again. Whoa. Whoa. That can do many things to you, including give you goosebumps and have the hair stand up on your, on your head, I'll tell you.
That actually did. We came into this valley one afternoon and boom, there was a female calling and it just reverberated off. And it's a primeval effect. You just have this feeling that it does something to you, even if you never heard a tiger call like that before. But we are hardwired back to caveman times and certain things that we don't know exist. I've walked in the jungle before when I first started doing wildlife, and the hair on the back of my head stood up, and I had no idea why. But there was a jaguar following me, and somehow we know it. My brain knows it. I don't know anything. I was just started on this, so. I want to show a tiger in the landscape. If I'm going to show a landscape, like I put the elephant before, I want to show the tiger in the forest and not just do a landscape. Hardest thing to do, I had the opener of Yasuni last January of the canopy in the Amazon. That's the best forest picture I've ever taken. But the hardest thing to photograph is a forest, you know. And I wanted to put a tiger in it. And to show the different habitats with the tiger, because I don't do that many portraits. And a tiger in the Sundarbans crossing the open water from one area to another. And I grabbed the long lens, because this helped tell the story of their habitat better than showing a tiger tight with water around it. Shooting tigers is dangerous and difficult. I can get portraits, but to tell the story is going to be tough. It's a lot harder than I thought it was going to be, and this guy scared me to death. I was photographing, he was sawing logs, sleeping in the shade, but he jumped up like he shot out of a cannon. Luckily, he only went a few steps before he just moved off and left me alone. Humor in photography, I mean, photograph this, all of a sudden she's looking at something. I don't know what it was, but I love the picture. And it's also a portrait. Try to find a different way to do camera traps. There's a water hole. I photograph it from above. You know, this is the problem where I had a problem. Photographing tigers in India is political. My God, everybody's in competition with each other. I had someone write a letter to the Minister of Environment, complain about the fact that I had camera traps up that were there legally, and I spent 2 years getting permits that any Indian photographer could do also. Just like, have you ever worked in a national park as a pro? In this country, it's difficult. We need all the paperwork taken care of, as well it should be. But I was forced, and I keep saying, if people cared about big cats or even tigers, they wouldn't be only 3,000 left, would there? We don't make a lot of money off this stuff. National Geographic, Creative, or before the image collection, resells all our pictures. We don't make a lot of money on resale on these animal pictures, trust me. That's what these people would think. The animal that loses is not the human animal or me. The animal that loses is the tiger that I was forced to take down my camera traps. And the first, last person to put camera traps up in India on tigers was Nick Nichols. He got pictures that people haven't seen before. I was lucky enough to get pictures too, but I was forced to stop by jealousy amongst Indian photographers. We need to save our planet and compete against ourselves. Because I'll tell you right now, most of the pictures I see of the tigers all look the same. And pictures that look the same don't save anything or anybody. And so let's do good for what we're photographing. Think about the species you're working with and the land. This is what I do right here. I take my tripod that I do use, tie it with clothesline and cable ties to the elephant, my seat, and I use other different cameras that are on top. And that's how I got the cover of the book. And we'll get to that quickly. Like I said, I already mentioned tourism. It's important to photograph it. Try to get a moment when they're seeing the tiger. I still haven't got the tourist picture I want. Use panning when the prey and the tigers. Show what tigers normally do, which is eat, sleep, and play. I used a camera car that I'd seen in the basement of National Geographic. Now there's a guy from the UK that sells these that works a lot in Africa. Can't remember the name of it, but they had made this for TV and I got him to work with this. Nick had a robot on lions and he was able to get incredible stills and video camera side by side in it. This thing, you know, it wasn't made for this much weight, but we got a couple interesting shots because you're trying to find a different way to do things. I need to photograph animals leaving the park, so I show, I need to find a location where there's a fence. There's not too many fences, so I find this and there's mom taking three of her cubs out because she can't find enough prey on the inside. And when there they are, here she is outside of the park. Use your top ISO. This is 12,800. My editor likes this picture because she's never seen it before. It's a guy with a spotlight on top of an elephant trying to get a tiger out of the five-star resort, the Inn Beyond Resort in Bandhavgarh. And she's getting ready to jump the fence and leave. But this is what happened. I knew these guys. They were on the elephant moving a tiger out of the village. They happened to kill the brother of the guys on the elephant. They worked for the park to save tigers. They invited me to come to the cremation. It was a most uncomfortable thing, but they wanted their brother to have more life. This is one of the brothers here, and that's the other brother. And that was their brother who came to visit them and didn't tell them they were coming. Poaching, again, making friends of the people that you're working with. And I got a text saying, if you drive 12 hours, you can get a poaching picture. So we drove 12 hours. And I got it and it ran in the magazine. And other things, these are the guys in the jail, that was outside. You try different ways to do things. Mating, it's a violent affair, so I use a little bit of movement. Cubs running. Now, cubs was the hardest thing because I went to India with two females that were having cubs. By the time I got to the park, they had been killed. One by poisoning by the guy you just saw behind bars because it ate his buffalo and he wasn't compensated by the park. So those are called revenge killings of predators. It happens with all big cats. And the other one was hit by a Jeep. So I had no cubs, but I didn't pack up and go. I asked for an opportunity to go back with me only because I have great support in India without my assistant. And the day I landed, the female that you saw lying in the water, she killed two people by accident. Got a call in the Delhi airport as I'm flying down to hurry up because there's something happening by the director of the park. Knew I was in India, just arrived the night before. That means I couldn't use the elephants. I got there and it took me 24 days to get the picture. I would sit on an elephant and read my Kindle. You spend hours and hours and hours watching a tiger sleeping or not being able to do it at all and being in a Jeep and I know I can't get the picture. I need to get the picture. So I luckily, just a couple hours over 28 days. And this is what I'm doing. See the tiger? She's going to sit up there. The elephant can't go any closer. We didn't want to disturb her. So do a landscape with the tiger in it. I did want to do something besides read my Kindle. And then take a closer shot. There she is. And I could see the cub right there. See his ears? He He's nursing. And then it looks at me. I got to 600, just 600 bear. And then I got the shot. I would not look at the back of the camera. I've worked for National Geographic for 23 years. I had to ask whether it happened or not with my local assistant on the back, my driver, guide, and friend. He said, did the cub actually do that? Because you're focusing, composing, you know, everything. One frame out of five, all I got was five frames. Because the elephant's always moving. It took me 3 hours to look at the back of the camera and I cried like a baby. I couldn't stop crying because it's been 28 days. So I got the shot and it became the cover of the book, Tigers Forever. Thank you very much.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.